other aircraft at the rear is almost ready with a second load. Speed without hurry is an important factor. For the takeoff, the pilot usually requires a light tail, so the walking wounded must move forward up the gangway and remain there until the machine is airborne. Once the aircraft is gaining height, the walking cases can return to the rear to leave the gangway clear for the orderly when making his rounds. It must be remembered that very few passengers have ever flown before. There may be signs of nervousness, or someone may feel sick. It's up to you as an orderly to reassure them, offer them something to drink. Alternatively, a cigarette will often do the trick. Tea will always be acceptable to those who have perhaps traveled a long way without a break for a meal. The serious cases will need all the care you can show. The facio-maxillary, for example, whose jaw is splinted, will not be able to drink from an ordinary mug. For him, the special feeding mug with rubber tube attachment is the answer. By using this, he can control the flow to suit his ability to swallow. And make sure they're reasonably warm. They may not always be able to tell you if they feel cold. In your pannier number one, you'll remember, there are bed socks. This is an occasion where you can use them. When he's finished his drink, make him as comfortable as you can by removing any saliva from his mouth. When using the same mug for different patients, it's hardly necessary to remind you to wash it out before using it again. Check up on the penicillin drip from time to time. It may run out. An occasional chat with those well able to talk will be appreciated. They'll have plenty of questions about their destination, which you can answer, and few will refuse your offer of a cigarette. You may come up against this sort of thing someday. The patient with the fractured skull has woken up. He has no idea of the severity of his injury, which has unbalanced his mind temporarily. He complains that they're shutting him about from pillar to post, in planes and out of planes, and doing him no good at all. Humour him, and give him all the answers that will reassure him. Tact and diplomacy are valuable accessories to your equipment. Here again is a complication which you should be on the lookout for. Our patient with the thigh wound isn't looking so well. He can give no proper answer, but you'll probably find the reason for this change when you investigate. From the signs, it's pretty obvious that a secondary hemorrhage has developed. Immediate action is needed, so the first aid outfit comes into service. Undo the outer bandage as far as possible without exposing the wound. Then apply a new pack and re-bandage it tightly to arrest any further flow of blood. During the rest of the journey, this will need watching in case of a recurrence of the trouble. Even now, he's very restless and in some pain, so it may be advisable to give a morphia injection to promote rest and, in addition, relieve surgical shock. To sterilize the area of injection, an iodine swab is made ready. To prepare the morphia, remove the tin foil wrapper and remove the glass cap. push the pin down to pierce the neck of the ampule, withdraw the pin, and squeeze the ampule to express a drop of morphia from the needle. Form 3118, you'll remember, must be marked to show what injections or special treatment you give.